Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome into the LakersNation.com podcast. It's game day. Lakers, Warriors, tonight. This is the biggest game of the season. I'm not being dramatic. This is the biggest game of the season for the Lakers. A must win. We're going to talk a lot about this game tonight. We're going to talk about where the Lakers are in the standings. We're going to get into the mailbag as well. But now, it's the time for optimism. So joining me, it's Matt, the Optimist Peralta. Optimism Prime himself. Matt, how are you doing?
Doing pretty well, Trevor. Like a lot of people, still a little bummed about the game against the Timberwolves. But you know what? We are moving on. We have the Warriors tonight, and we're going to hope for a win.
Yeah, definitely need to get a win. In fact, let's just get into it, right? We'll dive into it. I'm sure we'll have plenty of time to rehash what happened in the Wolves game when we get to our mailbag segment at the end of the show. So we'll do that then. Right now, let's look ahead. This is the standings currently. If you're a podcast listener, I do have the standings up on the screen here, but essentially the Lakers are sitting in the ninth seed once again. I mentioned this on a video on the YouTube channel yesterday, youtube.com/LakersNation. Essentially, all that matters right now is the loss column. That's the easiest way to look at this and really get a sense of where everybody's at. The Suns and Pelicans have 32 losses. The Kings have 33 losses. The Lakers have 34 losses. The Warriors have 35 losses. So you can see how compact everything is. The range of outcomes for the Lakers, it's 6 through 10. They could finish anywhere 6 through 10 right now. Matt, if they drop this game tonight to the Warriors, they drop to 10th because they would also not have the tiebreaker over the Warriors. Yep. So they would then fall to the 10th seed should they lose tonight to Golden State. What are you expecting to see out of this team tonight? And I guess first and foremost, do you expect to see LeBron and Anthony Davis play?
I'm going to assume yes. I feel like I don't know. I think in my personal opinion, I think the Lakers probably felt like the Timberwolves are going to be too much. And they figured if we're going to have to rest LeBron, either the Warriors game or the Timberwolves game, it's probably this game. So I'm expecting LeBron to be back. I think AD will also be fine. I think there was a report from Dan McMiniman during the game on Sunday that AD, there's some optimism AD would play on Tuesday, which is today. So I'm going to assume the two stars are there tonight.
Yeah, I'm in agreement. I think they are going to play. I think if it was second night of a back-to-back, they wouldn't have said LeBron's illness was, yep. You know, they would have said it was LeBron's ankle or whatever that was keeping him out. I think he's really sick because I saw a lot of fans saying, oh, LeBron's not really sick. He just didn't want to play in the game or whatever. Like, LeBron knows where things are at. LeBron knows how badly the Lakers needed to win that game. And again, they could have easily just said it was his ankle. I buy that he's sick. I think he was going to catch flack no matter what if he wasn't playing. Mm-hmm. But if he's sick, he's sick. I hope he's a go, obviously, for tonight's game. And then Anthony Davis, the eye injury, that was certainly unfortunate, but I think he'll be a go as well. This is, when we look at this matchup, Lakers-Warriors, what needs to happen for the Lakers to get the win? Because right now the Lakers are 1-2 against the Warriors on the season, but one of those losses you kind of throw out because it's the same thing that happened against the Wolves a couple of nights ago, which was Anthony Davis gets hit in the eye. This was the initial injury, and essentially the game ends on that play. That was it. Anthony Davis being pulled effectively ended the game, right? The Lakers weren't able to threaten after that. So I look at it as the Lakers and Warriors are 1-1, effectively, in terms of both teams being, you know, ready to go. What needs to happen tonight for the Lakers to get the job done here?
I mean, honestly, I feel like when they're healthy, just to keep doing what they're doing. I mean, I the offense is clicking, obviously. Defensively, I know there's still some issues, but I think they've proved a little bit in that regard. And, you know, going against the Warriors, this is a matchup that the Lakers know very well at this point. And so it's really just a matter of the formula is, you know, dominate down low, the painted area. I think the Lakers can pull out a win if they do that and stick to that.
Yeah, I mean, it's not by a lot, but I think the Lakers are the better team overall. I think they're the better team right now than the Warriors are, but that doesn't, in one game, it doesn't mean anything, especially in a game where the Warriors can easily get hot from three and beat you. Steph Curry, we know, can do that. He's a big game player and everything. This is going to be a big game. This is going to be a playoff game, essentially. This is going to be a playoff feel to it, but it is going to be the Warriors, their ability to shoot the three, going up against the Lakers and their ability to dominate in the paint. And that's going to be on Anthony Davis. He's got to have a massive game tonight. He's got to stay out of foul trouble. He's got to stay on the floor and be able to defend the way that we know Anthony Davis can defend. And Matt, I'm referencing when he picks up two fouls pretty early, he has to go to Olay defense. He can't protect the rim anymore in order to stay on the floor. So he's got to keep the cheap fouls off of him early. And he's going to have to be the best player. I think it's not out of the question to ask him to be the best player on the floor. And I think that's essentially what the Lakers need to win this game, is they need Anthony Davis to be the best player on the floor.
Yeah, I mean, go back to last year's playoffs, right? Like, all four of those Lakers wins, Anthony Davis had monstrous impacts on them. It's kind of the formula. Like, he is legitimately the true mismatch in this game between the Lakers and the Warriors. I know Draymond Green's an excellent defender, but I mean, they don't have anyone that can cover AD in single coverage. Like, there's just no one. Right. So they really need to play through him tomorrow, and, you know, hopefully he can deliver.
Now, what about the defensive side of the ball? Steph Curry, what is that? I mean, Austin Reeves has drawn some very difficult challenges recently. He's in a shooting slump, by the way. Hopefully he breaks out of that slump. But is it going to be a lot of Austin on Steph? Do you think we're going to see a lot of Spencer Dinwiddie? Maybe some Gabe Vincent, who should be a go in this one after sitting out last game against the Wolves because that was second night of a back-to-back. What do the Lakers throw at Steph?
Yeah, I mean, it's guarding Steph Curry, right? There's like no good answer for this. You can only hope to slow him down, really. I think you'll see a lot of Austin on him for shift. I think Darvin will probably cycle through both those options you mentioned, Spencer and Gabe. I think particularly Gabe. I know he hasn't really found the offensive stride yet, but defensively, I've liked what I've seen from him so far. So I definitely can imagine Gabe taking the Steph Curry minutes when he's on the floor there, and then obviously Austin in closing time and probably the fourth quarter and whatnot. So we just got to hope that Steph doesn't explode, because that's also just a nothing you can do about that kind of deal.
I'll tell you the other guy. It's Klay Thompson.
Oh, yeah.
Klay has one of those random, like, turn back the clock, I'm going to drop 30 and not miss any shots type nights, then you're in big trouble. If he has one of those, oh, wait, I'm not that Klay Thompson anymore, let's live in 2024, then you're usually okay. But if he happens to have one of those hot shooting nights, like unfortunately we saw from Naz Reid, you were the recipient of a outlier shooting performance from Naz. That's not saying Naz is a bad player. He's not at all, but he doesn't shoot that well every single game. Klay is that guy in this game for me. If he happens to have a hot shooting night against the Lakers, they're in big trouble. If he performs more the way he has through much of the season, you can probably weather that storm and get by.
Yeah, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the last time the Lakers saw the Warriors, Klay went off the bench, right? I think that happened pretty early in the game, and you kind of knew from that point forward that the Lakers were in for a long night. So yeah, I'm in agreement. It's really just try to make sure that you don't have multiple players going off, containing the role players, that sort of thing. And then hopefully it'll turn it into a game between your superstars. And in that case, I think the Lakers have an edge.
Yeah, I agree. But if, let's hope, fingers crossed, LeBron James, everything's good with those flu-like symptoms, that he can get out there and play. This to me, Matt, we've seen certain games where obviously LeBron pushes down on the gas pedal a bit more, right? Where he turns it up. We saw that game against the Clippers late in the game when LeBron said, no, I've got Kawhi, right? And then shut him down. You see these moments where LeBron says, now it's time to really go. And the rest of the season, he kind of paces himself, as he should. I think this is one of those nights. I think this is one of those nights that LeBron James pushes down on that gas pedal a little bit more, and we see more of a playoff intensity out of him. And the way that you know, particularly, is early on in the game, watch his defensive closeouts. Watch how quickly he is making rotations and things like that. That's how you know he's really locked in, and everybody else will follow suit if you see LeBron very active on the defensive side of the ball. But Matt, that's what I'm expecting to see. I'm expecting to see a locked in, 100% full go, pedal to the metal LeBron James in this one. And I think if you get that, then you're right in the superstar category. I give the advantage to the Lakers.
Yeah, I mean, I think this would be good to point out too, right, is that since LeBron sat out Sunday, he hasn't played since Saturday, so that's an extra 2 days rest. And then after this game, the Lakers don't play again until Friday, so yeah. Yet another 2 days of rest. And it's against the Grizzlies too, so if I'm LeBron and I'm trying to play chess, right, I'm thinking, okay, I basically have had almost a week off. The next game I play, I'll have extra days off again, and then I'm also playing a weaker team. So to your point, I think he's got really no excuse but to just go full throttle the entire game.
Who's the X factor for you in this game?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are a lot of options here. Sure. I think I'm going to stick with Rui Hachimura. I think that he's also just another bigger wing player that the Warriors in their starting lineup at least don't really have a good answer for. You have to assume Wiggins is going to go on LeBron, Draymond's going to guard AD. I think Rui's going to be in a position to take advantage of matchups here and there and score. So I'm going to go with Rui Hachimura because I think he's been playing really well. Offensively, he's been great. And if he can continue that, I think the Lakers have a good chance to win tomorrow, or today, I should say.
Now Wiggins hasn't been playing here, but I think the sense is if he's going to come back, he'll come back against the Lakers.
He's playing.
Yeah. He's play. I mean, it's what happens, right? It's what happens. We all know the way it goes. Everybody is Kevin Nash standing up out of the wheelchair when it comes time to play the Lakers. Everybody suddenly gets extremely healthy. I'm looking right now. He is listed currently as a game time decision.
I'm assuming
he's going to be a go for this. But LeBron and AD listed as game time decisions as well. But I'm assuming that he will wind up being a go. I'll tell you what, the guy that I'm going to be really keeping an eye on, it's D'Angelo Russell, who did not shoot well last game against the Wolves. But he's had such a great season that I know everybody throws their hands up and says, well, here it is. That's just what D'Lo is now. This is playoff D'Lo and all that. I've actually got confidence in D'Angelo Russell at this point. I don't feel like the hot shooting this season is a fluke, is an outlier or anything like that anymore. I don't think there's people who look at D'Lo and say what he's done is it's fake. It's not real because it's not the playoffs and that's why he's done what he's done. He's been pretty consistent for a guy who's known for not being so. He's been pretty consistent to the point where he has a poor shooting night last game. I feel like we're going to see a bounce back tonight. And that doesn't mean that he's going to go drop 44 or something, but 25 plus, that's what I'm expecting out of D'Angelo Russell, including hopefully a timely 3-point barrage from him at some point.
Yeah, that's a good one. And it's also a good point that, he didn't have a good shooting game the last time he saw the Warriors, and he didn't have a good shooting night against the Timberwolves just a couple days ago. So, D'Angelo typically is the knockout punch for the Lakers in most games recently. He gets going, you can almost bank a win for the Lakers. So if he is able to knock down, like two or three in the span of like 2 minutes or something, I think the Lakers will be in good shape.
Oh, Wiggins is listed as probable now to return against the Lakers.
Told you. Yep.
Yep. Yeah. We knew that was happening.
Well,
okay.
Well, that's it for this game.
That's something to keep an eye on with D'Lo, right? Because what the Warriors do and what a lot of teams do is they'll take a guy, especially if LeBron's off the floor, they'll take a bigger defender and put that player on D'Lo to try to put a lot of pressure on him, knowing that D'Lo's not the smaller, super quick guard that's going to blow by a guy like Wiggins. And so they'll use that to try to shut him down. But I'm looking for D'Angelo Russell to still have a big, big game in this one tonight.
Yeah, I mean, he has come up in some pretty big moments. I think this is literally like the last week of regular season basketball. So if we're going to get another scorching performance from him, I would gladly take tonight. That would be great.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let's get into this. Just real quick, looking at the standings again here. To give everybody an idea of what's on the line right now, not only is tonight big in terms of not wanting to drop to the 10 seed, if the Lakers want to move up, again, 6 through 10 is still available. Those are the potential landing spots here for the Lakers. If they want to move up, the number one thing that has to happen is I don't think the Lakers can lose again. Now, is it mathematically possible for them to lose again and still move up? Yes. But I think they need to win their final three remaining games. I think they need to win out. So obviously that's key number one. The other things that we're looking for, though, it's the Suns, the Pelicans, the Kings. At least one of those three teams has to lose two games, Matt, in order for the Lakers to move up. Do you think that's going to happen?
Well, I mean, I think it would be good to point out that the Lakers play the Pelicans in the regular season finale,
which does help. If the Lakers win out, automatically that's a loss to the Pelicans. So they would have to lose one other game for the Lakers to leapfrog them somewhere along the way.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to get at, was just if the Lakers win tomorrow, today, and I mean, I'm going to assume they take care of business against the Grizzlies on Friday. Yeah, I mean,
they better.
They better. So yeah, no, I think there is a good chance that the Lakers do win out. It's just gotta hope that everyone else above us loses.
So we've got Sacramento at OKC tonight. We've got Phoenix, or we've got the Clippers at Phoenix.
Oh wait, and pause, Trevor. Did you see that Shea is available for the Kings
game? I did, which made me excited. It made me excited. The Lakers don't have the tiebreaker against the Kings. So the Kings really have to lose two games. Like the Kings, if the Lakers get into a three-team tie and the Kings are involved, the Kings poison the three-team tie, essentially. And it turns into the Lakers being the bottom team there because they went 0-4 against them. But come on, OKC. Hand a loss to Sacramento. Shai Gilgeous-Alexander coming back. Maybe he thought he was playing the Lakers and that made him recuperate or something. I don't know. But him coming back to play the Sacramento Kings, that is, I hope that's officially what's going to happen. But that could be huge for the Lakers.
I mean, OKC still has something to play for too. So sure, it makes sense. Yeah.
Sure. And then we have New Orleans against Portland. So, I mean, just give the win to New Orleans right now. Portland's not even playing basketball anymore. But the Kings could potentially lose. What do you think the Clippers are going to do? Do you think the Clippers, because my concern has been that the Clippers are just going to tank this game, especially because they know it would hurt the Lakers.
I mean, they're not locked into four, but
they're pretty close.
Yeah, like it would not surprise me. It just wouldn't.
Yeah. It would be a very
They've got a perfect excuse. Yeah.
Oh boy. Well, so there's obviously a lot of other things going on around the NBA tonight that's going to matter potentially, but the most important thing, again, that the Lakers do pick up the win. Don't forget, guys, during our games, during every Lakers game, come join us on Playback, playback.tv/LakersNation. You can hang out with us, watch the game with us. We have the simulcast going over on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel as well if you want to listen to our play-by-play and hang out and chat and everything. So make sure you come join us. Obviously, big game tonight. We need all hands on deck. Everybody needs to get in there. And we are somehow, some way going to get through it together. Matt, I'm already so nervous for this. I'm going to be on pins and needles all day waiting for this game tonight. And I'm like strangely confident because I feel like I think this Lakers team, despite the performance against the Wolves, if they've got everybody, I feel like they've taken it to another level. I'm talking myself into they should win this game tonight. But we've been burned so many times in the past too. That pain, it's still there. Just a little bit.
This I don't even need to say it. It's just too easy of a relationship analogy, so I'll leave it there. It was low-hanging fruit, man. But I'm in agreement. I mean, look, I think that the Lakers, when they're healthy, and I think they've proven it enough now to me in these past 2-3 weeks that I think this run is real. So if LeBron and AD do play, they got basically everyone. I'm confident in the Lakers' chances to win this game. I do like the matchup for them. And yeah, I mean, like we've seen the peak of this team. We've seen what they can do when they're locked in. Mm-hmm. So yeah. I'm gonna be optimistic and hold on to that and hope that that's what they come out with. Because again, I think you can even tell, like in all their post-game quotes recently, a lot of the articles that we have up on LakersNation.com, Darvin Ham, AD, LeBron, etc. Everyone down the line has kind of reverberated the same thing. And it's just, we know we have to win our games if we want to move up. So I'm going to trust that the players understand how big this game is for them tonight.
This is, I mean, massive, massive, massive game for the Lakers tonight. A must win. I'm sure the Warriors are saying the exact same thing. But for the Warriors, like this is, you can get up to the 9 seed and you'd have home court in that first round of the play-in. The Lakers have a legit chance to get up to, again, 6 is not impossible. It's unlikely. You need the Suns, the Pelicans, and the Kings to all lose 2 games, which mm-hmm. can't happen. But like the 7-8 is realistically possible. There are scenarios too, Matt, where the Lakers went out and still stay in 9th. Yep. Which would feel like the theme of the season, where the Lakers winning and winning and winning and winning and just stuck at 9th because the Western mm-hmm. Conference this year. But if they could get this win tonight, especially if the Kings lose, and definitely if the Pelicans find a way to lose to the Blazers, I will feel a lot more confident in their ability to move up to at least eight and be in double elimination territory for the play-in.
You and I are in the same mindset. That's all I really care about. I mean, look, six is obviously like the ideal position, but to me personally, I've kind of given up on that dream. So if they can somehow finagle eight, even seven, hopefully, but I'll settle for eight. I'm with you. As long as it can get out of double elimination territory, I think I feel pretty good about the Lakers' chances of qualifying for the playoffs.
All right, let's dive into the mailbag. By the way, your official prediction for tonight's game? Are you going Lakers win before we get to it?
I have to. Manifest. You must say that's these things out loud and manifest. Lakers will win tonight.
I've got Lakers by four.
Okay.
I'm gonna say Lakers by four.
What is the spread right now? I'm curious.
Right now it's I think it's either 2.5 or 1.5. Last I looked.
What would you take there? It's basically a coin flip.
Yeah, I would. I mean, if I'm predicting Lakers in four, I'm gonna take the over. I'm gonna say the Lakers cover. Oh, it's 2.5 right now. Lakers okay. Minus 2.5. I would take Lakers on that.
Okay, fair.
They show up. They're showing up tonight. They're gonna show up tonight.
We're not getting stood up.
That's right. That's right. We're not getting stood up. We're gonna go to the restaurant. The Lakers are gonna show up,
and we're gonna have a good time.
We're going to have a good time. Whether you're a world-class athlete or you're a podcaster like me, we all understand the importance of mental and physical well-being and proper recovery for top-notch performance. That's why I'm excited that Unified Healing is sponsoring this episode of the LakersNation.com podcast. Unified Healing is a new and super innovative global network of wellness centers powered by Energy Enhancement Systems, or EE System. If you haven't heard of EE System yet, you'll want to listen up. Technology that promotes wellness, deep relaxation, purification, and rejuvenation. Whether you're here in Los Angeles or hundreds of other locations across the globe, access to a center is easy and affordable. So if you're interested in experiencing the EE system technology for yourself, go to unifiedhealing.com/LakersNation to learn more and find a center near you. That's unifiedhealing.com/LakersNation. No material or testimonials on the Unified Healing website are intended to be viewed as medical advice or a substitute for professional medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. Always seek the advice of your physician or other qualified healthcare provider with any questions you may have regarding a medical condition or treatment and before undertaking a new healthcare regimen, including EE system. Let's get into the mailbag. M Dread.
Oh, man.
Yes. This is comments coming from after the Lakers lost to the Wolves. So people are there's going to be some negativity here for us to wade through. So Matt, your optimism is going to be useful here. M Dread said Austin Reeves ain't reliable. AD always down. Just pack it in. Now, on the show, Ryan and I were on the show, Ryan Ward, and we talked about how negative people were being and things like that. And while it's understandable, it's frustrating to lose a game like that. I also said, and of course, I had a lot of people just get mad at me and say excuses. But I said, given the context of the game, no Anthony Davis, no LeBron, second night of a back-to-back, the Wolves had just suffered a bad loss to the Kings in which they shot terribly, like an outlier bad shooting night. All of that does not bode well for the Lakers. So when you tell me all of those things, each one of those things is a negative for the Lakers going into that game against the Wolves, I'm not surprised that they dropped that game. But I have a lot of people very upset and saying kind of the sky is falling, that's it, it's over. I'm not there. I look at this whole like they need to go 3-0. I think they can do it. I think they can go 3-0 and close out the season that way.
No, I legitimately think they can too. And look, I think we're doing the Timberwolves a discredit here. Like that team is very good. They are tied for number one for a reason. So I think even if the Lakers were fully healthy, there was no guarantee the Lakers would win that game. So yeah, look, I understand. Like the Lakers have been winning a lot of games. I think the fans understand the urgency of needing to win all these games. And so when it feels like a proverbial step back, then yeah, it's frustrating and you want to fire off these kinds of takes. But yeah, like, if the Lakers take care of business this week and they move up, I don't think anyone's going to be complaining. So I think I'm going to save any sort of outrage until we see how they've handled these next few games. well, actually the last games of the regular season in general. So
Buck said, so we're not going to acknowledge that AD has gotten injured in every high pressure game after the All-Star break. Suspicious to say the least.
I would argue that every game, I would say every game after the All-Star break has been high pressure.
Right. And AD has been remarkably available this season, hasn't he?
This is like a career high. I don't think it's a career high in games, but it's like the most since like 2018 or 17, I think.
Yeah, he's, I mean, he's missed. Now, in Lakers fans' minds, there's two games where he's gotten injured early. So technically, on his stat sheet, he still played in those games.
Sure.
But essentially, those games became losses. In one case, I firmly believe the Lakers would have beat the Warriors last game had Anthony Davis not gotten hurt. But that flipped into a loss. I don't know what would have happened in last night's game had AD not gotten hurt. Who knows what it would have looked like. But there's a couple of games here where he's gotten hurt early in a game and then the team goes on to lose. Those are going to stand out. But I don't think it's fair to say to suggest that somehow he's doing it on purpose by saying it's suspicious or something. Like, Anthony Davis has battled through a lot this season, a lot of, you know, injuries and things like that that he's fought through, trying to shed that whole street clothes label and all of that. I just don't think it's really fair to, considering the job that AD has done. He's played in 74 games at this point. So again, he's missed five games total. This is the most games he's played. He played in 75 games twice for the Pels. So tonight, when he plays against the Warriors, he will be tying the most games he's ever played in an NBA season. So I don't think it's fair to look at AD and say, oh, this is suspicious. He's, you know, he's gotten hurt. He just gets hurt in these high leverage games as though somehow he's doing it on purpose. The fact that he's played this many games says otherwise.
Yeah, I mean, I'm glad you brought up, you know, the career totals, because I had just looked at it recently because it felt like he's played in a lot of games this season, which he obviously has. But to me, it felt like he was either at or nearing his career high. So good to know. And yeah, there's zero reason why he would need to fake injuries like that. Like, he's been dealing with a lot of like nagging things throughout the regular season. So if he wanted to, you know, sit out a night, he'd have a lot of reasons or a lot of things to point to and say, yeah, this hurts. But kudos to him. He's obviously taking on a more leadership role this season, which I think has been the most impressive thing about him so far this year. But yeah, if he gets hurt in high pressure games or whatever, it's probably because he's trying a lot harder than he normally would. And, you know, knowing AD, all the following and all that stuff, he's going to get hurt. So
yeah. Trey said, oh, the AD falls. Trey said LeBron could have took some damn Tums and played, and AD wears some damn goggles. These two always get hurt at the worst damn times. Well, damn, Trey. he used damn three times in two sentences. So Trey says LeBron could have taken Tums and played. I think I broke Matt the Optimist Peralta.
Can someone on the pod who's listening to the podcast please clip? Well, damn, Trey.
We can use that as a drop.
That's so good. Can we make it an award? Award, please.
wasn't it CJ McCollum years ago who said,
"I'm like, trying, I'm Jennifer."
I'm trying, Jennifer.
Well,
oh no,
I can't wait till this goes on YouTube.
Oh boy. What have I done?
It's the best $5 I've seen spent.
LeBron could have taken some tugs.
I'm here.
Okay, I'm here. we've got Matt is back. So I saw a lot of this going around, and I know it's frustration the Lakers lost. I don't know how sick LeBron was or wasn't, but I see this. I've seen ranging anywhere from the he's not even sick at all to he's faking it, right? Or he could just take some Pepto-Bismol or Tums or whatever, and he could totally still play. Right. I've also seen the Kobe would never, and MJ would never, and all that sort of stuff, right?
Yes.
I don't know. Like, for me, well, I don't know. Matt, you tell me first. How do you take all that kind of negative? You're the optimist.
Yeah, man. Look, to me, this signals a few things. The first thing I thought of initially was, oh, I think LeBron was really serious when he said he doesn't care where they finish in the standings. I think he really just needs to get to, like, you know, to win. Like, he's basically just saying, like, wake me up when the games actually matter. So that was my first thought. My second thought was, he's going to get killed for not playing this game. And if the reasons really are listed as flu-like symptoms, then yeah, that's not going to go over well with the fan base. So look, I think that if I'm going to be the optimist here, I'm going to say that he looked ahead to Tuesday today and said, this game's more important. I need to be absolutely 100%. Let me sit out this game and bring my best for this game. So that's where I'll leave it.
But he's missed second game on a back-to-back before. Why to the flu-like symptoms thing rather than he would, I mean, I guess we could speculate in terms of why, but why go to flu-like symptoms and not just say ankle injury management?
Maybe
or whatever.
The medical staff was playing Mad Libs. Who knows?
they've got a wheel of maladies and they just spin it and
wheel of maladies. Dude, we've got so many like award, like segment game show ideas. This is great.
You've got a wheel with like back soreness. What is it? Knee effusion. That one's come up a few times for the Lakers this season.
So many things I've had to write for the LakersNation.com injury updates, like ankle tendinopathy.
Yeah, there you go. That's another one.
Yeah,
man, there's some serious word scores there.
Yeah, I love it when like players. Sorry, this is like such a tangent now, but like I like it when players like break like small bones and like.
Oh yeah,
the news reporter guys got to make sure they get like the fifth metatarsal on the whatever thing, and I'm just like, dude, this must be so difficult to tweet out in real time.
Right, that's what you notice, Ryan, because we all get sent the injury report, right? Ryan always just copies and pastes it in there. He's like, I'm not gonna try with this stuff.
Work smarter, not harder, man.
That's right.
He's a veteran. He knows.
What about AD wearing goggles? Do we just call up Kareem?
James Worthy.
James Worthy. How big of an adjustment do you think that would be? Like, would it be? Is it asking too much for him to try goggles at this stage?
To try, no. I mean, even if it's just for a few games, because I mean, like, imagine he gets and they're playing the Warriors, Trevor. Like, come on. Yeah. Like, I don't need what to say suggesting? It, but. Nothing, just that they have player or players that have a history of making contact with other players, sometimes in not great areas, and Anthony Davis is he's not the strongest flower in the garden, so I would just prefer that he takes the necessary precautions.
Are any flowers strong?
Anthony Davis is. He can be a strong flower.
Okay.
Sorry, yeah, I'm still trying to. I'm sorry. I'm still thinking about. Well, damn, Trey. I'm so sorry. So sorry.
So we do have a question coming up in just a bit here about that exact topic. About are people going to target AD now? His eye. So let's get to that in a minute here. M Dread said, "Bron always sits big games. I'm out on him." Oh, he said, "Let's go Boston." M Dread. Come on.
You can take your $2 back.
That's awful.
That's dirty money. I don't even want that.
Yeah. That's gross.
Oh.
That's gross. You can't do that. Can't do that. Alicia. Oh. Save us, Alicia. Why would LeBron sit out when we're fighting for our lives to climb in the standings? So what? It's a back-to-back. This is critical time. I'm trying to give LeBron the benefit of the doubt and say, like, maybe he like literally couldn't keep his lunch down or something, like flu-like symptoms.
You better hope so. That's the case, man.
Right?
Yeah.
I could be surfing. Said I think D'Lo struggles when sped up. Yeah, I think this is why teams try to pressure D'Lo so much, or try to put a bigger defender on him to really just swarm him. Because that's the key, to is not to let D'Lo go at his own speed or feel comfortable.
No, I mean, I agree. Right? I mean, that you, when he seems to be pressing too much, or when he's got someone on his hip the entire time, like, yeah, like he is prone to bad decisions and shot making. So, yeah, if he can avoid that issue, great.
Lee said tough loss, but Master Lock. Master Lock, Dylan Brooks, Cam Payne, yes, and Jay Crowder.
Good. As always. This is great comment.
Right?
Perfect. 10 out of 10. No notes.
The one at the bottom, LeBron and Anthony Davis out for the season, in parentheses, paper cut. That's on the wheel, too. The wheel of maladies. this is... It's like... Dude, now, let me ask you this.
Sure.
Do you picture, when we talk about this hypothetical wheel, do you picture like the Price is Right wheel?
Yeah.
Or do you picture like the horizontal, like the Wheel of Fortune wheel?
No, I think of the Price is Right wheel.
Okay. That's where, like, I go to.
Literally. The Price is Right. Oh, mic fell. Man, this show is getting off the rails. yeah. And then whatever it lands on.
Hey, let's talk about Austin Reeves here, because this comment says Austin Reeves is always overthinking everything and getting worse. Austin is in the midst of a real, of a significant three-point slump.
Yep.
He's been struggling. There's some advanced stats that have showed that the Lakers have been performing better when he's off the floor. I think you need Austin Reeves if you're going to get to where you want to go. You need him to find a shot, and he's built up enough equity to where he has the green light to continue shooting, and you have to trust that he will eventually find it. But what are you seeing from Austin right now, Matt? And how do you feel about these struggles?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's been weird. I feel like I don't know, this is maybe me just spitballing or grasping for straws, but for whatever reason, I feel like Austin presses a little bit more after he turns the ball over, which he's been doing quite a bit recently, especially as he's assumed more point guard duties. I think that is kind of bleeding into the rest of his offensive game. I think that when he's on ball, he is, you know, kind of caught in that, do I need to play make here? Do I need to shoot and score? Like, you know, try to get myself out of this funk kind of deal. So yeah, I just kind of feel like he's still figuring out like his brand of basketball, so to speak. And then the other thing too, is I just think that, you know, the more shots he misses, I think he's trying to gun himself out of it. And, you know, he's not really that type of player. And yeah, it's been, the Lakers have been fortunate enough to have been able to survive it because they've got D'Angelo Russell and other players playing well. But yeah, Austin needs to go back to postseason Austin from last year if the Lakers want to make like any sort of noise.
I think I've seen an improvement on the defensive end of the floor from him. He's been putting in some work there, but Austin has, he's been, let me, I'm pulling this right now. Austin in the last seven games. Oh my gosh. It's worse than I thought. The last seven games, which is when the slump started, he's shooting 18% from three.
Ooh, that's
five bad. On 5.4 attempts per game. He's shooting 38.6% from the field to go along with 2.5 turnovers per game, 6 assists, though, and 5 rebounds. And I think Austin's rebounding has been a key factor in the Lakers' rebounding as a team has improved. Austin's rebounds have gone up. He's done a better job taking care of those mid-range rebounds. But Matt, 18% from three, that can't continue. You're not going to go far with Austin Reeves shooting 18% from three.
For anyone out there that is not good at math like I am, I had to do it in my head for like the entire time we were talking. So that's about, he makes 1 3 after every 5 attempts.
Yeah.
Not great. No. Yeah, no, look, I mean, I think the Lakers' offense is at its best when both D'Angelo and Austin are able to space the floor properly and take these off the bounce threes. If, you know, D'Angelo's not hot and Austin continues to be in this slump, then yeah, I think the Lakers are going to be pressed.
Let's get it going, Austin. Let's get it going. Avant Traders said, if Clippers beat the Suns one game, we're guaranteed 8th seed by going 3-0. If the Clippers beat the Suns one game, we're guaranteed the 8th seed by going 3-0. Is that true? What am I missing here? The Suns
Lakers
losing
3-0.
Oh, do the Suns play the Pelicans? Yeah. The Suns would play against the Pelicans, which means if the Suns only lose one game, that means they put a loss on the Pelicans too. Am I right in that? I believe. Dude, let me double check.
You know, we're at, what are all those GIFs with, like, the math equations? That's literally at this point we're of doing the season. That. Yeah.
We're doing that. Oh, no, the Suns don't play the Pelicans.
No, there's an... The Suns don't play Pelicans. The Kings, do they?
The Suns do play the Kings, yes.
Yeah, because I just did a I just did an NBA playoff standings post for LakersNation.com. Go read it, everyone listening. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I had to map out the schedules, and I remember there's a couple big games this week. Lakers Pelicans, obviously, too, next Sunday.
Maybe at this point, I've been staring at the standings for so long today, Matt, that it's like they're starting to move around on me and stuff. Like things are getting a little trippy here.
Probably good now. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. But there is a situation where, so I don't know if that's actually right, where if the Suns lose one game to the Clippers, the Lakers just have to win out because the Lakers don't play the Suns. That wouldn't put an extra loss on the Suns. But there is a scenario where if the Kings were to lose to OKC, the Lakers reclaim control of their destiny.
Correct. They would just need to win out. Yep.
Right. Where they would just need to win out. But is that even right? The Kings lose to OKC.
No, it would be right because if the Kings lose to OKC, that's 9.5 in the games behind column. And then if the Lakers beat the Warriors, and it's 9. And then the Lakers have a half game.
But the Kings have the tiebreaker over the Lakers. So if the Kings were to win out. That's what it is. That's what it is. It's because the Kings play the Pelicans. The Kings play the Pelicans. So that's what it is. So if the Kings lose tomorrow to OKC or tonight to OKC, then what would happen is when the Kings play the Pelicans, if the Lakers win out, the Kings play the Pelicans and either the Kings take their second loss, which means the Lakers can leapfrog them, or the Pelicans lose, which then by the Lakers beating the Pelicans in the last game of the season,
they're going to
the Lakers would leak from them. So yes, if Sacramento loses against OKC, the Lakers reclaim control of their destiny in terms of getting into the 7 or 8 seed at least. And that's, again, if they can beat the Warriors. So that's the if that result happens, then the Lakers can play their way into at least the 8 seed at that point.
Yes, we are big Thunder fans, essentially.
Let's go Thunder. Let's go Thunder. IS said, Kings Pelicans, one will lose. That he Ob on Traders broke that down. I didn't read far enough, Matt. That was the problem. Said, we have the most iconic player to wear goggles in NBA history at our disposal for info if AD needs it. This is exactly when Ream wore the goggles. I don't know if just knowing someone that wore goggles, like, I don't know if there's much of a learning curve. Like, there's a certain way.
How much
that
more
you
of an
wear
advantage,
the goggles, right?
Like, do you get from knowing?
Like, no. You're doing it all wrong. You're putting on those goggles with one hand. Let Big Cap, let Kareem come and show you. You put the goggles on with two hands, and it changes. And then suddenly the problem is solved, and Anthony Davis can wear goggles. I don't think there's a goggles learning curve here. I think it's on each individual to adjust to actually wearing the guy and how they actually feel on that person.
Yeah, I understand what the comment is trying to say, but
yes.
I think if AD does decide to go the goggle route, I don't necessarily think he has to consult Kareem about how to play with them on.
Cam said, far stretch, but if the Kings end 47-35, the Suns, Pels, Lakers tie at 34, could we still finish as a 6 seed? Yes, that's the scenario where the Lakers would finish as a 6 seed. Yep, if it's Suns, Pelicans, and Lakers all tied, the Lakers get the top spot in that group. Remember, the Kings, essentially the Kings are poison. That's the way it works. If the Lakers are in any kind of a tie that includes the Kings are poison to the Lakers, and they will drop the Lakers down. Now, if it gets to a four-way tie or something and the Lakers beat the Pelicans in the last game of the season and still somehow it's tied, and it can get complicated, right? We'll see what happens over the next, 6 days here. But if it's a three-way tie between the Suns, Pelicans, and Lakers, right now the Lakers would be the top spot in that group. Okay. Here's what you were alluding to, Matt. Dante says, so if AD plays on Tuesday and gets hit in the face again, you don't think that's suspicious? AD's been hit in the face back-to-back games. Teams know they can hit him in the face and knock him out of the game.
Ooh, foul play.
Is that... I don't know. Like, I want to not believe that an NBA team would specifically target Anthony Davis's left eye because they know that if it gets hit, it swells up and his night is over. However, there's a few players in the league that I would be particularly concerned about trying something like that. And to me, Draymond is one of them. Like, you just, he's very unpredictable. You never know what's going to happen with him. I'll tell you what, Matt, if early in the game, AD pump fakes and Draymond comes down and hits AD in the head, all hell's going to break loose.
You're not wrong. I'm with you. I don't. Maybe this is my naivety or my just, you know, me being just too nice of a person and giving players the benefit of the doubt. I would imagine that teams aren't targeting players that are hurt just to get them out of games. Yeah, so I don't think it's suspicious. I mean, do I think it's annoying and frustrating when it happens to Anthony Davis? Absolutely. Like, him and LeBron have been getting hit in the face or in the head a lot recently. I'm going to assume that no one is doing that on purpose, but I think it also depends. Like, let's just hypothetically say it happened. Like, you know, I think context matters here. Like, what was going on? Was it a play on the ball? Like, was he going up for a shot? Yeah. Like, that kind of stuff. Like, I just think that it needs a little bit more parsing out. So, yeah, I think just going back to the question, though, like, I'm choosing to think it's not suspicious. Like, I don't think there's, like, damning evidence one way or the other, but I'm just going to assume that players aren't playing dirty right now.
Yeah, that's... I want to believe that. But if AD gets in, given how big this game is, if something happens, it's given that now everybody's seen it. Everybody in the NBA knows now. You hit AD, it's happened twice. And I don't believe it happened intentionally in either occasion.
I agree, Anderson.
I don't think he did that intentionally. I don't think Trayce Jackson-Davis did that intentionally when the Lakers played the Warriors and he initially got hit. But now everybody knows. Now everybody knows you hit AD in that eye, he's out of the game, right? So if it happens, it's going to be difficult to... It would have, the context, as you said, matters depending on how it happens, because there's already going to be the immediate suspicion that it was done on purpose. Now, if it's a guy's not even looking and just happens to flail and hit, like, people will still be upset. But if a guy goes to, like, block AD shot or something and comes down on his face, and there's any way that you could look at it and say, oh, he did that on purpose, it's going to be a problem.
Yeah, and I'm sure Adam Silver would be thrilled to have to deal with that.
Yes, absolutely. Poor Adam Silver, by the way. Like, he's got to... If he had any hair left, he'd be looking at the standings every day, just pulling the rest of it out.
Well, right? Damn, Trey.
Right, damn, Trey. I mean, think about it. If you're Adam Silver right now.
Yes.
Zion... LeBron, AD, Steph Curry. Right? At least what right the way it's situated right now, at least one of that grouping is not going to be in the playoffs. Right? You know, in fact, day one of the play-in. Right now it's Lakers, Warriors in the play-in. One of those teams, and it's not lose and then you get another shot like the last time the Lakers played the Warriors in the play-in years ago. Adam Silver watching LeBron and the Lakers against Steph Curry and the Warriors in a loser goes home play-in game has got to be thinking, man, how somebody's got to be telling them the numbers. How much money are you losing by these guys going home right now as compared to Steph and the Warriors or LeBron and the Lakers actually getting into the playoffs?
You know, there's a world where like two out of three of LeBron, Steph, and KD are not in the first round.
Yep. Yeah, if Phoenix slips, I mean, right now New Orleans, if they get ahead, absolutely, that could definitely happen.
This is like the literal and metaphorical changing of the guard.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's what we're seeing. A loaded West. All right. Emmanuel said the Lakers are letting Minnesota win, or let Minnesota win to get the one seed.
Yep. That's exactly what happened. That's I will it. Choose to believe it.
That's it. But then that would also have the Lakers believing that they're going to get the eighth seed. The well, whole point being happen. To avoid Denver.
This could happen.
Yeah, it could. Okay. Eric said, right on, Ryan, sky is falling generation. We were talking about how upset fans got after. And look, I was more upset, Matt, during the game. I was very pressed. I was having to tell myself, like, you know, don't say anything too crazy here, right? While we're doing the play-by-play. I was not happy. Ryan was much more go with the flow. And there were a few times during the play-by-play, I was like reminding Ryan, like, no, Ryan, you don't get how big this game. Like, this is a huge deal, Ryan. This is a big game, right? After the game, though, when I really took a moment and let everything that happened kind of sink in, I wasn't as mad at the thinking, oh, the Lakers should have won that game. Sure. If you told me before the game, no LeBron, no AD, all the context, I'd be like, oh, you're probably not winning that game, right? Is it still frustrating? Yes. But why do you think it is? To me, anyway, and you can tell me if you think this. I think that people react in a stronger way, let's say, now when their team loses than they would have 10 years ago. Do you agree with that? And why do you think that may be, if so, or why is it not?
Yeah, I have a lot of thoughts on this, actually, but I'll try and condense them as much as possible. To answer the basic premise of the question, I really do think, and this might sound like a cop-out answer, but I think a lot of it just has to do with social media and how basketball is covered nowadays. I could just talk as a Lakers fan, right? I think a lot of it is the frustration of having to listen to negative narratives for like weeks on end because the team is losing. That's one. Two, it's, you know, the griefing you're getting from other fans and other fan bases because everyone's just so accessible to each other now. So, you know, take like, you probably have to go a little even farther than 10 years ago, but like, just imagine you're watching the game by yourself or with your buddies and that's all you've got to talk about the game with. And then now you're being able to interact with hundreds of people online who are all angry and upset and complaining about the same things you are. I think it's just kind of like almost a mob mentality at that point. Not a mamba, a mob mentality. where, you know, it's just like everyone's kind of joining the chorus and supporting the same notions or the same issues. Like, look, I think like for a really good example is the Russell Westbrook thing. Not to bring him up because I don't like him. It's just like, Once the narrative started rolling about how bad he was and how he was the problem and all this other stuff, like that's all it was the entire year. Everyone sharing that opinion, people looking for evidence in games to like support that narrative. Like it's just it's kind of toxic if we're being honest. So yeah, I just think that just having more of a platform for everyone to kind of create and run with their own narratives, and then that's what people are talking about versus, you know, what's actually happening on the court. I think that's just kind of why you'll hear fans a lot more often like complain and you know, quit on the team a lot earlier than they probably would have years ago, just because like they're just getting sick and tired of hearing the same things over and over again.
Yeah, no, I agree with everything you said there. I agree. I think that's what it is. I think it's now, you know, if it was 20 years ago, the Lakers lose. That sucks. In fact, the Lakers did lose 20 years ago, 2004, right? It was the Pistons in the finals. That sucked. But you turn off the TV and you go do other stuff.
Touch grass, right? Man. That's what I do.
Yeah. That's what I mean. And like, okay, you go on to ESPN.com and there's an article about them winning or whatever and that kind of stuff. But I mean, I don't remember what it was, at MySpace in 04. Like Facebook was really getting big at that point, or whatever it was at that point. It wasn't like there was like no escape. Whereas now your team loses, and man, like you feel like not only did your team lose, and that sucks, but you turn on First Take or whatever, and there's somebody ranting and raving about it there. You can't go on to Instagram you can't go on to X. You go onto any of your social platforms, which is what a lot of people do now, right? You're just, whatever you're doing, you wind up checking in on social media or whatever. And now you can't do that because you do that and you're just, again, getting hit by all that negativity. And so that, I think, losing the pain that comes with losing has outgrown the celebration, the great feeling that comes with winning, right? You win, it's almost like a relief. I don't have to hear all the negative stuff. And so I think that's just, it's just the reality of social media now. And it's kind of changed the way that we look at these games and why people get, or part of why people get so upset when the team loses and why they get so frustrated is because of that. It's so much more difficult to just walk away and shut that off when that stuff is found in every portal that you've got, right? So it's a challenge.
Yeah, I mean, like, I think you and I can probably talk about this phenomenon for a long time, because I think as people sure. that have covered the game and are fans ourselves, like, you kind of see both sides of it, where you get the, you know, unbiased factual reporting portion of it, and then you get the fan portion of it, and it just becomes kind of a really convoluted mess. And I think the other thing too I want to bring up is I think meme culture has a lot of things to do with this also. Sure. It sounds really funny when I say it like that, but like, look, like, how often do you find yourself hoping that your team doesn't do something stupid, because then people are going to be, you know, making fun of them for like a week? Like, yeah, no one. So I just think that there's a fear of, like, you know, getting embarrassed and getting piled on and all that other stuff. But again, like, you know, 20 years ago, when you don't have this much access to other people, it's not an issue, but now it is. So in conclusion, really, it's just, it's kind of unfortunate. I don't really think that this is going to go away anytime soon. And I just think that the way major networks and publications are covering basketball and other sports, really, like, a lot of it is, unfortunately, like, engagement farming. And when you get into like that sphere of coverage, then, like, I think you just kind of throw your hands up, because at that point, the problem is just too far gone.
Yeah, it's a lot of us getting a reaction. So, for example, like our guy, Sean Davis, he retweeted something earlier today, and it was a ranking. And I'm not even going to shout out the company because I know why they did what they did. It was a ranking of the title teams over the last 10 years.
Yeah,
and I saw they put the Lakers on the bottom.
Yep.
And I immediately knew exactly what they're trying to do, right? Do they really believe the Lakers are the worst championship team in the last 10 decades or 10 decades, last 10 years, the last decade in the NBA? No, I highly doubt that any rational person sat down and said a LeBron James and Anthony Davis led team is the worst, right? But they knew if they put the Lakers at 10, it's going to get a bunch of people to pile in and respond one way or another on either side, right? You're going to get a lot of reaction. And that's part of the social media environment that we're in now too. It's about putting out something that a lot of people are going to respond to. They're going to retweet or requote or whatever it is now, and they're going to jump in and kind of pile on that. And I think it creates an environment where people do get more frustrated with these losses, because you get even more of that kind of stuff going around. And it's a real challenge, I think, for the people deal with now today. That wasn't the case years ago. As many benefits as there have been with the technological advancements that we've seen in the last 20 years or so, this is kind of the downside to it, is it's harder to escape if there's something bad going on with your team. And what we love about Lakers fans, Lakers fandom, is how passionate fans are. But that passion can turn into pain when bad things happen to your team very quickly.
I agree with all of that. And it is unfortunate. And, you know, I was laughing because we were talking about, you know, engagement farming, and you brought up like the whole Lakers thing. Like, why do you think the Lakers, every newsbreaker has to throw in the Lakers at the end of every trade rumor or free agency?
Oh, rumor? Yeah. Yep.
Of course.
And that's not even the newsbreaker. That oftentimes that's from agents.
Yeah.
That will say, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. My guy has the Jazz, the Magic, the Nets, and the Lakers are interested. Why? Because they know they put in Lakers and everybody's going to go, what? The Lakers? Right? That's going to get the attention. And not even just from fans, but from other teams around the
NBA. Honestly, honestly, maybe I shouldn't have joked about that, because that's what feeds us through the summer, Trevor. So Sorry to anyone I offended. No, please keep including the Lakers in every single rumor, and please rehash the news every single time.
It's a real thing, though, right? I mean, it happens, and it's something that we tend to, you know, or at least I do. I tend to like give the little PSA. Hey, just know, not a lot of rumors aren't going to come true. You know, yep. A lot of rumors aren't. They're not. It's not going to happen. Some stuff does. Here's how we cut through what's real and what's not. Here's how we look at things. Here's how we try to find what has the ring of truth. And here's a phenomenon that can happen where you're going to see the Lakers name. I promise you, Matt, the Lakers are going to be connected to every single big star, big-ish star that comes available this summer. Their name is going to be added in. Part of that is they're really going to be interested. Part of it's going to be you want the Lakers name in there to drive interest. It's just it's the way it goes.
It's a thing, man. Like I think that for the off-season basketball outlets, I think it is a blessing when the Lakers have assets and cap space and things to use to get players, because then they could just he could be interesting on the Lakers. Let's just throw him in there. This guy, trade. Oh, they could make a trade for this guy. Like it's just one of those things where it comes with the territory of being, you know, the biggest team and the most popular one in the world. So
let's wrap up with these two. Shelly said, more concerned with Austin Reeves' slump and Ham's coaching. We talked all about Austin Reeves' slump. Where are you at on Darvin Ham at this point?
You know, funnily enough, I don't think that the coaching has been as big of a deal. And coaching is so vague to me. Like, I'm curious, like, if they mean from an X's and O standpoint, or are they talking about just like the other, you know, managerial in-game things, which I think most people are referring to, right?
I think it's the in-game managerial stuff that we mainly look at.
Sure. Then, I mean, like, he hasn't necessarily done anything, I think, egregious. Do I think his substitution patterns and other things are... I don't know. I think he's been okay. Go ahead.
To me, it's the timeouts.
Sure. Yeah. Like I know.
Those bother me.
I do not blame you. I think he is always. I mean, I was gonna say maybe like a possession or two, but sometimes it's more than that. So. I think that. He is, I mean, like, look, the Lakers don't go on this like this recent stretch without him either. Like, I think that'd be it would be disingenuous not to at least bring him up for, you know, why the Lakers are playing so well right now. I think he's been okay these past few weeks. We get to the playoffs, he does something stupid or dumb, I'm sure everyone on social media will point it out, and we can probably talk about it then.
Yeah. No, it's fair. If he's going to get the criticism when the team is losing, he deserves some of the credit when the team is winning. That's true. I think most people in general are still very down on Darvin Ham for what's happened this season. Still think part of it is the West.
Trevor,
what?
We were talking about the Lakers and trade rumors and stuff, right?
Yeah.
Can you imagine if the Lakers did trade for Trae Young, and I get to say and tweet, "Well, damn Trae," on the Lakers Nation account next season?
See, that's where you're gonna have to have this clip ready.
That will be the most niche Lakers Nation meme ever.
That will be. We'll have to make a t-shirt out of it or something.
Oh my god, that would be perfect. I need them to trade for Trae Young now.
All right. A Courageous said D'Lo and Reeves is the problem we lost. Both lost their confidence tonight. D'Lo turned into a passer. Reeves continued his ball turnover career. AD soft.
Make sure you get all them characters in, man. Yeah, absolutely.
I thought there were some moments where I thought D'Lo and Austin were kind of gunning in that game.
I did too.
But they had to, right? Like, that was the Lakers' chance when AD was out.
Did you want
their
shooting?
Chance was, yeah, was they had to go on a heater in order for the Lakers to come back. And so you got to put up those shots. Were they a little bit overzealous? Perhaps D'Lo? Sure. But I mean, either D'Lo's going to take that shot, and if he makes them, maybe they go on a run. If he misses it, okay, you were going to lose anyway had he not taken the shot, and he passed it off to, like, Torian had a bad game. You passed it off to Torian, but, well, you're going to lose the game anyway. You might as well have D'Lo start taking those shots, see if he can go on a heater, and it pull you back in the game.
Oh, yeah, I agree. Like, I mean, I don't know what you wanted to do at that point. Like, Anthony Davis missing the game, or being forced out of the game, I should say, that opens, like, what, 20 field goals attempt, 20 field goal attempts or so? Like, yeah, someone has to take them. The other thing too, and I this one always bugs me, but, like, when you guys call, like, a player soft, like, I would just like to see, like, a regular person suffer the same sort of injury, like, one of these days, and see if they're still considered soft. That's all. Because I have been poked in the eye several times playing multiple sports at this point, and it is not fun.
Oh, I would be out. I would be out. I'd take the DNP. Yeah, I'd be on the injured list.
Especially That's considering it was the same eye that he got hurt in.
Yeah. That would be getting hit in the same eye. AD is quickly becoming NBA Scott Sterling. And just his eye.
Just the eye. Yeah.
Well, so hopefully AD's eye does not get targeted tonight against the Warriors. Once again, the biggest game of the season. That is not me being overly dramatic. Lakers have got to get the job done. They've got to find a way to get this win tonight. LeBron, AD, fingers crossed. Hopefully they are both a go for this game. The Lakers are going to need them. They're going to need guys to step up. This is a big one, everybody. Lakers Nation, come join us over on Playback, playback.tv/Lakers Nation during the game. Don't forget as well the YouTube channel, youtube.com/Lakers Nation. Hit that subscribe button too. Matt, this was a lot of fun. Thank you for coming on and joining the show. I always appreciate it.
Trevor, I'm so sorry. I feel like at this point, every podcast I'm on, it's not the most professional, but you know what? Whoever's listening or watching these videos and listening to the shows, I'm sure you guys are laughing along with us. So I'm happy to be here.
We needed some light moments to cut the tension, because I'm going to be on pins and needles enough today. That's for sure.
I just wait for the tweets tomorrow, Trevor. I'm on the account. So for anyone that follows the Lakers Nation Twitter account, I will be on the sticks per usual. If you guys see Will Damn Trey, make sure to retweet it and quote tweet it, and make sure you tell everyone that you heard it here first. So
because you know what it's coming from. You know, you are now in on the inside joke that we just developed here on the show.
You are. That's how you know you're a day one fan. So
there you go. There you go. All right, real ones. Thank you guys for joining. Till next time. See ya. And stay safe.